Next, we have the public comment period. Is anybody here for anything that's not on the agenda? You can have maybe up to 5 minutes, or a few more, I guess, if you need it.
Yeah, well, hopefully it's not longer than that. We just did an exercise where we could only talk for 3 minutes, so I think we've got that down.
All right.
Mr. Mayor and City Commissioners, we are so excited to be here presenting the 2016 the class of Leadership Garden City. And in just a moment, even though they don't want to be recognized, we're going to call them up, because Allie's giving me orders that they have to get their picture taken with all of you. So in just a moment, we're going to call them up. But Leadership Garden City, we have been in business for over 28 years. And so this year, we are really excited about hosting this class this afternoon. Now, not only did they do in training inside our city and learn a lot about our city, do civic engagement, develop some leadership skills, but they also get the unique opportunity to go to the Kansas Leadership Center. And so we're excited about the things that not only they're learning and they're taking to other places, but also they're bringing the things back to our community and really exercising leadership so that we can really make our community the best community here in Kansas. So I'm going to call their names off to come up. Is that right, Allie? I have to do a check-in because I don't want to get in trouble. So we also have a couple of facilitators. Allie is our facilitator also. Allie Medina, Patricia Long, you want to stand, Patricia, and Janine Radke are our facilitators for this class. So I'm going to call your names if you'll come up, and that way Allie will get your picture all together. So we have Robin Burkamp, Vicki Harshberger, Clayton Holub, Christy Huber, Jamie Johnson, Jerry Coleman, and Richard Powers, Bill Powers. So I forgot your formal name, Bill. So we'll get a quick picture here. This isn't like a firing squad or anything.
Mary, you want to come up and
yeah.
join them?
Yeah.
Or all the commissioners.
Yeah, if the commissioners could join, that would be awesome. This would be. And no one has to lay across the. Well, no, Roy does.
What?
Commissioner Sesson has to lay across everyone, so.
Show up the
leg. Yeah.
That there for 6A, huh?
Yeah, if there's no other public comment, Mayor, Commissioners, ready for item 6A. The governing body is asked to consider and allow the mayor to proclaim October 2nd through 8th, 2016 as Public Power Week in Garden City. And I'll invite Mike up for just a couple minutes to talk to you about what Public Power Week is.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Commissioners. Public Power Week is a time where public power all across the United States is celebrated. There's over 2,000 municipal electric utilities that make up the public power sector in the United States. Particularly here in Garden City, it celebrates a time where we can celebrate that we provide reliable, affordable electricity, and that the Garden City Electric Department provides to our community. Public power puts the citizens of Garden City first, gives us a chance to place emphasis on locally grown, locally owned, and locally operated power systems that help strengthen our community. Our service is safe and reliable. We take pride in the fact that we're serving our neighbors and friends here in Garden City. And the remarkable thing is that this is 102 years after the fact that public power was started in Garden City. So a long, long time ago. Today, we have some of the electric department here with us. The electric department has 22 employees, has a substantial amount of infrastructure in place that they maintain and operate. We serve 11,389 residential customers, 1,037 small commercial customers, and 456 large commercial customers here in Garden City, excuse me. And I think the proclamation, Mayor, kind of says everything else, if you're willing to read that for us, that would be great.
I'll make a motion that we approve the proclamation as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the Public Power Week proclamation. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Whereas the City of Garden City places high value on local control of community services and therefore has chosen to operate a community-owned, locally controlled, not-for-profit electric utility, and as consumers and owners of our electric utility have a direct say in utility operations and policies, and whereas the Garden City Electric Department provides homes, businesses, farms, social services, and local government agencies with reliable, efficient, and cost-effective electricity, employing sound business practices designed to ensure the best possible service at not-for-profit rates. And whereas the Garden City Electric Department is a valuable community asset that contributes to the well-being of local citizens through energy efficiency, customer service, environmental protection, economic development, and safety awareness. And whereas the Garden City Electric Department is a dependable and trustworthy institution whose local operation provides reliable, affordable, environmentally responsible electricity to build strong communities. And whereas the Garden City Electric Department strives to continue to bring lower cost, safe, reliable electricity to our community homes and businesses, just as it has since 1914, the year when the utility was created to serve all the citizens of Garden City. Now, therefore, I, Chris Law, Mayor of the City of Garden City, Kansas, do hereby declare October 2nd to the 8th, 2016 as Public Power Week, to recognize the Garden City Electric Department for its contributions to the community and to educate consumer owners, policymakers, and employees on the benefits of public power. Our community joins hands with more than 2,000 other public power systems in the United States in this celebration of public power, which is best for consumers, business, the community, and the nation. Signed and sealed this fourth day of October, 2016. How about if all you guys come up for a picture? It's a lot of tan shirts. I think we all take it for granted when we walk in and flip that switch. About all those guys and all the things they do and during some dangerous times, you know, during storms sometimes. So thanks.
Thank you.
Mayor and Commissioners, item 6B, the governing body is asked to consider and allow the mayor to proclaim the month of October as National Disability Employment Awareness Month in Garden City.
I'll make the motion to approve the proclamation as presented.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to proclaim October as National Disability Employment Awareness Month. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Is anybody here with, right? Yeah, I thought
yes,
so.
We are.
Come on up and tell us a little bit, and then we'll read this. And
absolutely. Right here, Ken. Yeah. Unless you want to go closer to that.
No.
All right. Well, Mr. Mayor, Commissioners, thank you for having us here today and considering October to be Employment Disability Awareness Month. I brought with me Kenny. My name's Tom. I am the job coach here at Mosaic in Garden City. Kenny has graciously agreed to come and help accept this proclamation. He has been working at Walmart since 1992.
Oh, wow.
He's been there for 24 years and still going strong. So, he's a great, great person to come help us do this. So, thank you very much for seeing this month as the Disability Employment Awareness Month. Thank you.
You bet.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hang on there. We'll read it and then get a picture.
Okay.
Whereas the month of October 2016 has been designated as National Disability Employment Awareness Month, in order to celebrate and recognize individuals with intellectual and development disabilities who make important contributions in the workplace, and whereas employment is vital to the independence, empowerment, and quality of life of Americans with disabilities, and whereas the landmark Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990 removed barriers and enabled many individuals with disabilities to find more opportunities to use their gifts and talents in the workplace, and whereas the United States Congress, by joint resolution approved August 11, 1945, has designated October of each year as National Disability Employment Awareness Month to recognize the contributions of Americans with disabilities and to encourage all citizens to help ensure their full inclusion in the workforce, and whereas the goals of this city properly give recognition to those who directly help people with disabilities gain full access to training and employment, which help create productive and satisfying lives, and to live as independently as possible. Now, therefore, I, Chris Law, Mayor of the City of Garden City, do hereby proclaim the month of October 2016 as National Disability Employment Awareness Month in the City of Garden City, and call upon the citizens of Garden City to observe this month with appropriate programs and activities. Furthermore, I encourage the citizens of Garden City to seek information from those organizations with expertise in matters concerning employment for individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities, signed and sealed this fourth day of October
2016. Mm-hmm.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank
you. And Vicki needs to have a picture with us too.
All right. Yep. Director of Aviation Powell will provide a report on the annual FAA report and from the certification inspection. Rochelle?
Hey, good afternoon. Usually I can come up here and say, hey, we did a great job, but this year is a little bit different. Our inspection occurred over a couple days in September, and we did have a couple discrepancies, so we'll go through them, and then if you have any questions or need more background information on them, please let me know. These are kind of some things that the inspector found. The first one is kind of a doozy, actually. Some of our lighted runway hold position signs. So the signs. How do I describe it? Okay. So at nighttime, the lights change frequency from a low to medium to high. And as you click up the microphone, they change frequencies. Well, the signs are supposed to stay illuminated during that whole time. There's a few signs of ours that shut off for a couple seconds and then they come back on. The FAA inspector decided that that was a discrepancy. Since this time, we've worked with the sign manufacturer to resolve the issue, but as well, he's provided some information that the signs are actually allowed a 5 to 10 second delay. So we provided that back to the FAA. The FAA has looked at that information and there's some discussion going on, but then they've also decided that this is kind of a big project and they're potentially looking at funding for us to replace some of these signs. Through research, I'm still trying to figure out how old some of these signs are. And so we really think that that's part of the problem is that throughout the years of the modifications, these signs are kind of in locations that haven't been modified or upgraded. So working with older signs on a newer system is kind of causing those problems. So that one we're still working on, and it's probably going to be a couple more months till we get it all figured out and resolved. So we're still working through that with the FAA, the sign manufacturer. And the next one, marking signs and lighting. There are markings at the airport that have glass beads, and those are pretty much everything out there. Certain colors have glass beads, just kind of like any pavement markings you have in town or on the highway. One of our markings, that's a runway hold position, sign or marking on the intersection of two runways over the time, the beads have disappeared basically just through years of plowing and brooming and everything, and we did not notice that throughout the years. It's probably been a gradual deterioration of those beads. So during the night inspection, he noticed that. So since then, we've repainted that marking and the glass beads are installed and that issue's resolved. The third one is handling of storage and of hazardous substance and materials. Basically, when the inspector comes out, they inspect the FBO and all the fuel trucks as well as the fuel farm that we have. It's our responsibility to check those on a quarterly basis, and that is one of my job duties. So I check it on a quarterly basis. I checked it on Tuesday, no issues. Wednesday when he comes out and inspects it, there's a little tiny leak from one of the valves. So that was a discrepancy. So that was repaired the same day as the FBO has been very diligent about keeping that maintained and everything. So that issue's resolved as well. The fourth one, airport condition reporting. Part of the inspection too is to go through all of our paperwork. Every day we do two daily inspections. The ARF department helps us out with those as well, so we keep a record of all those. He went through them, noticed that there was some windsocks out on a weekend, and he then also checks our NOTAM records, which NOTAMs are basically information provided to pilots anytime that the basic lighting or conditions at the airport are not perfect. So he checked our NOTAM records and realized that there was not a NOTAM issued for windsocks being out. So that was a discrepancy, and part of the resolving that is to train staff to, hey, when a windsock's out at nighttime and we're not able to fix it, we issue a NOTAM. So we've completed that training and information provided to everybody. So that item's closed as well. I think I skipped one actually. Yes, I'm sorry, number four. there was one of our one-way hold position signs. That's kind of a critical sign. So when they're out at nighttime and we're not able to resolve that, basically change the light bulbs out so it's illuminated, we're supposed to issue a NOTAM. And during the night inspection, one of the signs was out, which is kind of normal. So I went ahead and issued a NOTAM, and then that issue was corrected. So those are the five discrepancies that we had on the inspection. So nothing critically safety critical that would cause harm to anybody. However, they are part of our Part 139 requirements, and we did mess up on a couple of those, so we've resolved them and are continuing to work to resolve the sign issue.
Thanks for the update, Michelle.
Yeah, sorry, it was better news. Usually it's good news, but this year was a little different. So.
Yeah. Easy to focus on the things that
didn't shut the airport down.
No. So. And you know, the windsocks, most pilots who fly at night don't look at a windsock because they're using their instruments to land. So there's a couple
Was it the lighting on the windsock, or was it windsock stuck to the pole like it does every once in a while?
No, the lights on the windsock were out.
Okay.
That was an issue. So there's just little things that we've kind of overlooked that we'll be more diligent about focusing on when we do our inspections.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, while you're up here, could you give us kind of a brief update on how the construction's going?
Yeah, currently we're in the process of building a taxi lane in front of our corporate hangars, as well as access to the ARF station, the aircraft rescue firefighting station, as well as a fuel farm. Construction's going very well. They've been working long hours and on weekends to get this project done before winter hits. So paving on the project's kind of split into portions, one being at the north and one being at the south, and then those portions are split in two phases. So tomorrow I think we're going to finish up paving on both portions of the first phase, and then do a couple of days of dirt work and saw cutting and everything, and then we'll switch the project. So it's going on schedule and going really well. So it's been a great project. So.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Annual certification inspection is a very comprehensive review, and while it is our responsibility to respond to the discrepancies, it kind of glosses over the fact that there's several hundred things that are examined that pass. And so while they're not super excited about it, I think Rochelle and her staff should be congratulated for another good review. By comparison, the last 3 years, maybe not as good, but certainly in line with sort of the history of that inspection that helps call attention to some things that over time may have deteriorated or may have been a particular oversight on a given day. The stakes are high, and so the criteria is high. And I would say this,
as it should be,
this review was a good one. And that first one she pointed out is particularly interesting because it's maybe a disagreement between the inspector and maybe what previous inspectors have considered to be passing or failing. If there is a heightened standard of what we're to provide, having the FAA be there and say, hey, we'll contribute funding to get it to this new higher level or higher definition of what we want, that's helpful to our airport. Item 7B is a presentation of the monthly sales tax report. You might notice that the city's sales tax compared to the previous month, or not, but the previous year September receipts was down. The previous year's September receipts was a very high month, and this year's September receipts is still a high month. But still a percentage point, I believe, down from last year's September 2015 number. We're still trending between 1% and 2% above 2015, so that's a good sign, but do have two consecutive months that are below the 2015, the previous year's two consecutive months. So we'll continue to monitor that. Still ahead of pace of what was budgeted for 2016 because we budget this number conservatively. All in all, a good sign. If there aren't any questions on that report, we'll call your attention to the meetings of note. Celine's calling around for those things that need reservations. I'll try to get you taken care of. It is a busy next 4 to 6 weeks. Any questions on the meetings of note? If not, we're ready for 9A, the appropriation ordinance. If it's approved, it'll be number 2420-2016A.
I move that we approve appropriation ordinance number 2420-2016A.
Second. Motion and a second to approve the appropriation ordinance 2420-2016A. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
Item 10A, the governing body is asked to consider and approve a resolution relating to the closeout of the Garden City Family YMCA Inc. 2009 IRB issue. If approved, it would be resolution number 2663-2016. The city issued industrial revenue bonds series 2009 for the Garden City Family YMCA in the amount of $1.1 million. This paid for the cost of constructing and equipping a 20,000 square foot addition to the YMCA. The bonds have been paid in full, and the YMCA intends to exercise its purchase options under the lease and has provided notice of its election to purchase the project on or about October 17th of this year. The city must consent to the exercise of the option to purchase, waive the 60-day notice provided for in the lease. The resolution authorizes the execution and delivery of 1, a special warranty deed, 2, a bill of sale, 3, a termination and release of lease, and 4, a satisfaction, release, and discharge of indenture in connection with the exercise by the tenant of its options to purchase the project. These documents, along with the authorizing resolution, have been prepared by the city's bond counsel, Mary Carson. Your alternatives are to approve the resolution or defer action to a later date if you're uncomfortable with any of the contents herein. Staff's recommendation is to approve the resolution. This has been reviewed and really handled in full by Mary Carson, the city's bond counsel.
I move we approve resolution 2663-2016 between the city and the YMCA.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to approve resolution number 2663, approving the sale of the project financed with the internal revenue bonds. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
All right. Item 10B, the governing body is asked to consider and approve the attached resolutions allowing the City of Garden City to participate in the Kansas Moderate Income Housing Grant Program from the Kansas Housing Resources Corporation and to prioritize the applicants. Carol?
Good afternoon. Okay, it's that time of year. We do have two applicants this year that would like to apply for the Moderate Income Housing Grant. We have that would like to partnership with the city. The first one is CG Investments LLC, and that is Prairie View Acres, which they did apply in 2014. And were not awarded the grant by AHRC. They are doing the development that's up off of campus with, for the first phase, they plan on having 58 units, which will include 13 duplexes and 8 fourplexes. They will all be for sale units, and they will be within the moderate range of housing, which is between 100 and 200,000. The second applicant that would like to partner with the city is Victor Arcos, and that will be for the Arcos addition. And this addition is just north on Main Street, north of Mary. It's an infill lot. There is, they did a plat. There's 5 lots. One of them already has a house that's built on it, but they'd like to fill in for additional houses. And for that subdivision, the houses will be the same range, one to 200,000. And for both the Arcos addition and the Prairie View Acres, they're both asking to receive a grant. For Prairie View Acres, they're asking for 400,000. For Arcos addition, they're asking for 200,000 for the grant, and they're both needed houses. They're both in the same price range, but one is a lot bigger of a project than the other one. The Prairie View Acres, I'm sure you're familiar with, they've had some problems with their infrastructure, so this is why they're applying again. But they plan on putting the houses in quickly, within a year, once they get that infrastructure all in. Arcos addition, they have a little bit of a different plan. He'd like to build a house and then sell it, use the proceeds to help build another house and sell it, and just kind of go house by house as he proceeds with his development. They both want to use the funds for infrastructure. And you're presented with two resolutions. They are both to approve these applications. And you've also been presented with some letters that we will be giving to KHRC. And that is prioritizing the two developments we have. We did have three developments in 2014. This commission decided not to prioritize any of them. None of them were granted an award. And this year we're asking that you prioritize the applicants once again. So your alternatives are to approve the resolutions and or not to approve the resolutions, and then to either prioritize Prairieview Acres over the Big Arcos Edition, or to prioritize Arcos Edition as your top priority over Prairieview Acres. And what they like, they understand, KHRC understands that they're both obviously great developments, and the city is definitely interested in both of them. They do like to see which one that the city feels will have a better chance of getting awarded the grant.
Is that why they didn't get approved last time? Because we didn't prioritize? Is that one of the reasons?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
And really, the commission's stance wasn't, we aren't going to prioritize it. The commission's stance was, we understand the KHRC has a criteria by which to evaluate these. And while the categories are known, the weighting isn't. So these are all good. Whichever one scores the highest in your rating system would be the one we prioritize. So your policy position was one of, we will acknowledge that KHRC's evaluation of this is fair, and however things shake out in that is best for our community. They didn't see it that way. They really wanted to see the commission, I think, take a what I would consider a political stance rather than a technical stance on these projects. Why? I don't know. Maybe as cover for them for deciding over one and not for the other, that they could have someone blame that on if folks were upset at them. So. Nonetheless, if those are the rules of the game, I think the commission, if it would like to see one of these happen, probably needs to pick one.
Okay.
And there is a chance, too, that if you pick one over the other, they both can be awarded. That's always an opportunity.
But what went on North Campus? I mean, it's already started, hasn't it?
Well, yeah, they started putting the infrastructure, and they've had some problems with the street infrastructure, the curb and gutter.
Is that resolved?
It has been, yes. Yes.
So it can go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the
it's
Arcos,
a little further along.
They are a little bit further along, correct? Correct. The Arcos Edition, they've got their plat approved. Right now, they're working with getting their engineering plans approved.
Well, the one on North Campus is, I mean, it's drug out for over a year, I know.
So yeah, they've definitely had some issues that have held them back.
Yeah.
We need to do a motion on each of these two resolutions. What about a separate motion on which one we prioritize?
Yes.
That isn't necessarily done by resolution, just a majority action.
Right, but a separate action.
Yeah, if you're interested in both passing a resolution, expressing support of both projects, then one of them would be resolution 2664-2016. If you take them in order by what they are on our agenda, that is the Victor Arcos project. Then resolution number 2665-2016 would be the resolution of support for the CG Investments project. And then after the adoption of that, you're free to, by motion second majority vote, identify one that you would want to give priority to. And then Carol, then you send off a letter to the KHRC that says that?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Along with their applications.
I make a motion to approve resolution 2664-2016.
A motion and a second to approve resolution number 2664, determining the City of Garden City to partner with Victor Arcos and apply for and participate in the Kansas Moderate Income Housing Program. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
Move that we approve resolution number 2665-2016.
I'll second.
Motion and a second to approve resolution number 2665-2016. Determining the Garden City to partner with CG Investments LLC and apply for and participate in the Kansas Moderate Income Housing Program. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
I'd make a motion that we select CG Investments.
As our first priority.
I'll second that.
I have a motion and a second to select CG Investments project off of campus as our first priority. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, motion passes.
There is no old business item. Under new business, item 12A, the governing body is asked to appoint one member to fill the vacant seat on the Cultural Relations Board. Allie?
Afternoon, Commissioners. The Cultural Relations Board has one vacant seat that expires December 2016, and they are recommending Vin Nguyen to the vacant position. That is the Cultural Relations Board recommendation. And you do have attached the applications that have been received as of this date.
I'll make the motion that we approve Vin Nguyen as recommended by the Cultural Relations Board to fill the vacant seat.
I have a motion and a second to approve Vin Nguyen as the appointment for the Cultural Relations Board. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Item 12B, the governing body is asked to consider and approve the purchase and installation contract of playground equipment for Santa Fe Park. Andy?
The Parks Department and the Park Advisory Board staff are requesting to purchase playground equipment for Santa Fe Park that we moved across the street to make room for the Juvenile Detention Center. And we sent out an RFP and we narrowed it down to four choices out of the four or five companies we sent it to and the 8 to 10 proposals that we got back. And so we have a proposal for $24,971 on a new playground equipment for Santa Fe Park that we would like to have. That includes the manufacturing company coming and installing that playground equipment.
Where do the funds come from? Out of your budget?
Yeah, we have the money in the budget right now.
So could you save any of the old playground equipment, or
we
can
think
you use
we
it?
Might, yeah, we think okay. We might be able to save a few okay. Small things to put in some areas. It'll be more going and looking and seeing what attachments, you know, because slides and things are on platforms. If we can find ladders through the manufacturer to attach to that to make up a standalone piece okay. of equipment. But there's a few small things I know we can use in some places.
You researched reusing and even I think tried to get some bids maybe to put the old equipment up, and that was proving problematic.
Yeah, we did look. I actually called a couple of the other cities in the area. It's been a while since I've done it. I believe it was Dodge and Liberal, and the answers I got back is when playground equipment comes in, we hire the manufacturer to put it up. And I've talked to a few of the manufacturers, and they talked like it'd be a headache for us to try to put it back up. And one company in town didn't want to touch it, and the other one has kind of balked at it. And so it's a difficult proposition to give it up.
And it's not the same, I mean, the equipment's not the same once it's been removed.
Right.
You know, it doesn't install as new, you know, and has some issues. And that you spent some time looking at all that, I guess, is where I'm going with that. It wasn't just, let's just get new equipment because we want to. This
right.
Putting the other stuff back the way it was going to be an issue.
Talking with the manufacturer, the expected life is 15 years on a piece of playground equipment. However, they go farther than that. That's kind of where they put that mark, and they probably do no warranties around that number. This piece of playground equipment is 14 years old. And so to put that back up, we're probably pushing that life expectancy towards the end of it as well. So.
Andy, is that stuff still usable, and is there any liability or safety problems with using it?
Some of the smaller stuff may be reusable. Liability, there technically isn't law that says this is how it has to work. However, there's an organization out there that really pushes standards to be followed by playground manufacturing companies, and really it's more of it go through law on negligence rather than you broke this law. We would be seen as negligent if we did something, but we wouldn't put it back together if we didn't think we could apply to those.
So is there an option to be able to maybe give that away to some organization that could use that on their playgrounds if they could make it safe and wanted to use it?
You probably could. I just don't. There are a few pieces that would need to be replaced if the removal process had damaged some of the pieces, and those aren't that they're not cheap to replace. And so that would be a little bit of the expense of putting it back together. There again, I don't know what the legal implications would be of handing it over to somebody who didn't tell them to put it up if a kid got hurt.
The reason I ask is because here a couple of months ago, the commission got to go through on a citizens' night out, and we went up to a apartment complex up north on Mary Street. They had to buy their own and did have a little bit of stuff there, and they had to buy it. The residents had to buy it. No one else would pay for it. Mm-hmm. So that's certainly a place that could use more facility like that in there. And compared to the facility over behind, I refer to it as behind Gibson's. I can't think of the name of it.
Red.
It used to be Red over
Red,
there.
Red.
And, but they have a beautiful facility there, and just the two comparisons just really puzzled me that, of course, one is governmental funded and by HUD, and the other is private funding. But if it could be, if there was a donor and that would be willing to get rid of it, and if there was somebody that could refurbish that stuff and maybe put it up there with the landowner's permission, that would certainly give them some more stuff rather than taking it out to sell it as a scrap.
Sure.
We can look at it. Let's see. We'd probably just give it to them and get a release from them rather than be involved in putting it up or refurbishing it.
Yeah, I agree with that. That's why I'm saying giving it to somebody that's willing to do that refurbishing and putting it up. But
just for the business item on today's agenda, what we need direction from the commission is for Santa Fe Park, when the Juvenile Detention Center went there and we redefined where Santa Fe Park would be, our original intention was to just relocate the playground equipment. We've determined we're not able to do that. So the proposal is, this is the cost and the RFP that staff, with input from the advisory board, is recommending to replace playground equipment at Santa Fe Park. If in your deliberation of that you want to make purchase of this contingent upon finding another use for that playground equipment, then we probably just need to delay this decision and give us time to do that. I think our recommendation is we do this. If we could have reused the whole playground set, we would have done so at Santa Fe Park on our own park. Andy's told you that some of those pieces are reusable, the smaller pieces. We can find homes for those. I think our thoughts at this point is we may have homes within city parks for the entire public to use that, but we'd certainly be open to the idea of some other users, and that could be a separate item that we either update the commission on or bring back to the commission. So the policy issue for you today is the new playground equipment at Santa Fe Park. If you want to link that to the disposal of the old playground equipment, we can. We just probably aren't going to be in a position to make that decision today.
Go ahead.
We approve alternate one, which is also the Park and Tree Advisory Board's recommendation. Proposal number one with AFCO LLC for $24,971.
I have a motion and a second to approve the purchase and installation proposal number one. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Okay. Thanks, Andy.
Andy, you may make mental note to come back and follow up with the commission in the spring on maybe some options of what we can do with the old grip. Thanks. With that, commissioners, we're ready for item 12C. This is the consent agenda. There's no change in the consent agenda. It would be, if approved, item C1 through 3.
Move we approve consent agenda C1 through
C3. Second.
For motion and second to approve consent agenda items C1 through 3. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right. Commissioner reports, Commissioner Dahl.
Okay, first I'd like to thank the 22 city employees that work in the electric department. This is the Public Power Week here in the city, and I'd like to thank them for all the work they do. They provide us with safe, steady supply of electricity, and sometimes they're doing it in the middle of the night during storms, and so we're very grateful to them. I'd also like to say that I really enjoyed the informative meeting this morning. It was a great meeting. It's nice to find ways that the city can find ways to conserve our valuable resource of water. I'd like to congratulate Michelle and her staff for their certification inspection. I think it, even though there were some just little blips there, but overall they just do an amazing job, and we're very, again, very fortunate to have the airport that we do have. And also like to thank all the job coaches and organizations such as Mosaic that help our citizens with disabilities. And I want to say a special thank you to them for this awareness month. And that's all I have.
Mr. Finkhauser.
I'd like to congratulate all the leadership of Kansas, the people from Garden City. Did a great job. It's a great program. 28 years. So I know my wife's been a part of it. I've cooked a few steaks myself. So it's a great program. I also would like to congratulate the city electric department. And 102 years is a long time to provide power. I don't know whether that's a record or not, but it should be if it isn't. Also, attended the Transload groundbreaking, and that was quite an impressive. I didn't quite realize how big that piece of property is until you drive out there and look at it. And I mean, they had earth movers lined up. As soon as we left, they started moving dirt. So they're going to have that ready to go by the 1st of December. And the largest transload facility in North America. That's pretty impressive. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Mr. Sesta?
I echo the thoughts of the other commissioners. Just wanted to mention that the citywide cleanups going on this week as well as next week, so just be mindful. Just check the Garden City website to see where, what area the cleanup is in your area. But they started Monday, and it's one of the neat advantages that the city does to help our citizens keep our community looking as nice as it does. So again, just check the website for where they'll be at in your area. And then on Fridays, I think it's Fridays, if it hasn't gotten collected, you can call the city and have them stop by and pick up any debris that you've got sitting out. That's all I've got.
Mr. Dale.
I'd like to ditto what everybody said about the others. I'd like to say to the alumni and leadership of Garden City that I'm glad to see you here, some of you I know. I'd like you to feel free anytime to come to a commission meeting and sit in on it. We can give you 30 minutes if you have something to say. We'd be glad to hear from you, because you can be the eyes and ears sometimes that we don't have, and you may have a good point or a bad point, but we'll take whatever you got to say. We also have the fifth Tuesday of every month, we do have a town hall meeting, and ask you to come to those. And there you have more time to express yourself or express your neighborhood or other things that we don't see. And so help us to make our community better. I'd really like to see you pop in at any time you would. And as to what Commissioner Frankhauser talked about, the ceremony yesterday out at the old Mumford plant, it's good to see that facility going back in. The mayor said yesterday that this is a great thing for Garden City. But I think if you look at a map of the United States, the way I look at it is, if you show all the little cities, Garden City Star got a little bit bigger in the nationwide, as reviewing it as one of the leaders in transportation and transport facilities. So I think we can be glad for everybody that has worked on that from day one a number of years ago, and putting this whole thing together. I know with Lana and the staff and even some of the legislators had to do work on it, but it was well worth it, and I think it's going to pay off. And that star is shining brightly. That's all I have.
Thank you. You know, our two proclamations today recognized really people working, and wide end of the spectrum there, but still, you know, just people that are out in the community helping other people somehow, and we seem to have the opportunity to do that on a regular basis, which is one of the things that makes Garden City so great. So whether it's people helping people with disabilities, and the people with disabilities having the opportunity to be out in the community contributing, or whether it be guys in bucket trucks during storms, you know, we appreciate all that those people do every day, and that makes Garden City run a little bit better. I couldn't make it last week, but Maureen Miller retired from the police department, and so we thank her for her service, and wish her a great retirement, whatever that is for her, and hopefully that goes well. Next Monday morning, I hope some of you already seen this, at 10 a.m. is the 350-person pink hard hat ribbon, Kansas's first. The Shambaugh and Sons, that is one of the major contractors at the DFA plant, and DFA and St. Catherine Hospital and all are having this deal. So I would encourage you, if you weren't aware, if you can, come out next Monday morning to the DFA plant and be part of that little event, and at 10 o'clock that will include 350 people wearing pink hard hats for a aerial picture. And this has been done for a number of years around the nation. I think it started 15 years ago or something like that, but this will be the first one in Kansas. So if you're keeping your list of firsts that Garden City has, just add another one, because you might get to keep it. If you're one of the 350 chosen to wear a pink hat, you might get to keep it. But at any rate, just wanted to advertise that a little bit, because you know, that's a great deal. And a while back, I think it's Mark Lowe, the local guy for Shambaugh, Alan Lowe, right, approached me about participating. I said, sure, you know, and this is a big deal in their company and their parent company, EMCOR, and so they'll be doing something all over the, probably several countries, let alone just the United States. But, you know, the cancer is a bad thing, and breast cancer is a bad thing, and so this, you know, anything we can do to help that, you know, is good. So I think that's all I have, and if anybody has anything else, we're adjourned.